So have you ever seen the show Jersey Shore? Ever seen the show Jersey Shore years ago on MTV? So there was an episode of the show Jersey Shore. And Jersey Shore was one of these reality TV shows that was on MTV, like The Real World or whatever. And so on the episode, well, on the show, it's just a bunch of young people. They're staying in a house together. And then there's the usual conflicts that really mean nothing in the big scheme of things. Oh, he said that about her. She said that about him. Oh, they go to the club and they fight. And then all yada, 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 yada. So I thought of that. I remember I only saw one episode of it, really. And the whole episode, I could not believe it, was about what somebody said in a text message to somebody else.
Mm.
And there was this whole controversy surrounded by what somebody said in a text message with somebody else. And somebody was fighting, and oh, I didn't mean that, and oh, what was this about, and oh, I don't want to talk to that person. And this was the whole entire episode of this show.
In the grand scheme of things, it didn't mean diddly squat.
But I'm looking at politics today.
Aha!
I'm looking at the news today, and I feel like I'm watching that episode of Jersey Shore. And by the way, someone commented that I put it on Facebook Live that the Trump reality TV show continues. And someone who listens commented and really mad that I put that. I'm not putting that to bash Trump, because this really isn't Trump's fault. I'm just saying this is where politics is today. So the big story of the day is not the fact that there's a bombshell report that Hillary Clinton and her foundation got money from the Russians at the same time that a Kremlin-backed group got 20% uranium of America's uranium. No, that's not the big story with most of the media. The big story is not that American-backed troops in the Middle East took a city and have basically defeated ISIS. That's not the big story of the day. No. The big story in most of the media today is what Trump said in a phone call. What Trump said in a phone call. That's the big story today. So now all the speculation today is what Trump said versus what somebody else said Trump said. And what did Trump really mean by it? And is this phone call show how insensitive Trump is?
Uh-huh.
Or is this all a lie about what Trump said in a phone call? And all I can think to myself is, really? Really? This is where we're at today? This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. We are on until 10 p.m. tonight. Here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA, we're going to talk about a lot of different things. We're on Facebook Live as well. If you like the Beyond Reason Radio Facebook page, you can check it out. It's up there as well. We're going to talk about a bunch of different things, but that was just what I was thinking about today. That this was the story. Oh, and we have Mr. Tom Benson, who is producing as well. How are you, Tom?
How do? I'm doing well. The seasons are changing. I note that next week our overnight lows will be in the 60s. How about that? Fall is here.
Oh, wow. In the 60s.
Yeah.
That's good because the air conditioning in my car doesn't work.
Roll down the windows.
I'm still having problems with the stupid air conditioning in my car that we've thought we've had fixed like 10 times, and apparently we didn't, so... So that's good. I'm glad the temperature will go. That means I won't sweat every time I get in the car.
There you go.
I know. That's just a side note. This is what I've been dealing with today. All right. So here's the story. According to Congresswoman Frederica Wilson of Florida.
Of course.
Who has hated Trump forever. She says that Trump called the widow of fallen soldier David T. Johnson, who was killed in an October 4th ambush in Niger. Is it Niger or Niger?
Niger, I think I heard Niger. Somebody say.
Okay.
Yeah.
Pretty sure that's right. Apparently, according to this congresswoman, she said that what Trump said in the call was that Trump said he knew what he signed up for and only referred to the soldier as your guy. And everyone has gone crazy and saying, this shows how insensitive Trump is. Why would he say that? Knew what he signed up for? How could he say such a thing to a grieving widow? How insensitive. This is proof that Trump hates the troops, apparently.
Yes.
This is what the Democrats are trying to convince me of today. This is what the Democrats are trying to convince us of today, apparently, is that President Trump hates the troops, secretly hates the military, secretly hates the troops, secretly is insensitive when a troop dies and is cold-hearted and doesn't care. So this went on today, and I actually have Frederica Wilson, Congresswoman, continued on today. She was on CNN. Continued on with this point. She was actually reacting. Trump tweeted out that she basically made that up, and he has proof that she made that up. He hasn't put out any of the proof, but she has proof. So, and then she was on, the congresswoman was on CNN today, and this is what she said.
Well, I don't know what kind of proof he could be talking about. I'm not the only person that was in the car. And I have proof, too. This man is a sick man. He's cold-hearted, and he feels no pity or sympathy for anyone.
All right. So now, this isn't shocking coming, because of who it's coming from, who's saying that. And then Trump today responded. He was asked today in a press conference, and he responded. And by the way, Trump sometimes says things, and he doesn't look too mad. When he was asked about this, and he responded here, you could tell he was not happy. You could tell he was really angry at the accusation coming out that he doesn't care about the fallen troop, that he's insensitive. I've seen Trump, lots of different emotions by Trump. We all have. But I could tell today he is really not happy with this accusation coming out. This is what he said in response.
Didn't say what that congresswoman said. Didn't say it at all. She knows it. And she now is not saying it. I did not say what she said. And I'd like her to make the statement again, because I did not say what she said. I had a very nice conversation with the woman, with the wife, who is sounded like a lovely woman. Did not say what the congresswoman said, and most people aren't too surprised to hear that.
What's the truth, Mr. President?
Let her make her statement again, and then you'll find out.
Okay. Like I said, it's what did he say and what did he mean in a telephone call? I mean, I guess the fact that he called her, I guess that doesn't mean anything, because he's really just cold-hearted. But now they're trying to convince me that President Trump is insensitive for the troops, that doesn't like, hates the troops. Does anybody really believe this? I mean, you could say a lot of things about Trump. Now, I will say this. His comments earlier in the week, when he was asked, I guess he was asked about a reporter about calling the families of fallen troops. He said, well, I choose to call when it's the best time. And, other presidents haven't called, but I call. And that was kind of dumb, because there's no evidence of that. As far as I know, Obama has made those calls. George W. Bush has made those calls. Presidents have made those calls in the past. So to act like he's the first president to ever call families of fallen heroes is just, it's just not true. So if you want to criticize Trump, criticize him for that. But to say now that he makes the call when he didn't have to, talks to the widow and acts like, oh, he doesn't care about the troops. Are you really going to convince Trump's base? Are you really going to convince the military? Are you really going to convince me that Trump somehow hates the troops? I just don't buy it.
It's more red meat for the left.
I feel like it's all just political spin.
More, right. More reasons to hate Donald Trump.
I just don't understand. It makes no sense to me, to my brain, seeing what Trump has done. Now, he did have that criticism against John McCain. You know, I like heroes that weren't captured. He said that in the campaign. I think that was more directed towards John McCain personally than troops in general. But, I mean, it has been so obvious that Trump supports the military. In fact, there was that one video that went viral when he was getting out of the helicopter and the soldier there, you know, has to salute and his hat fell off. And Trump went to go get the hat and didn't have to do anything because the soldier can't move. Wanted to go get the hat, tried to put it back on. It fell off. He tried to put it back on and everything. You know, I'm supposed to believe that that guy somehow hates the troops. I don't buy it. Now, let's look at the original comment. I guess this is what we're doing now. We have to study every aspect of the comment. Let's say he did say he knew what he signed up for. Okay, so that could be taken two ways. It depends on the context. It depends on the tone. It depends on a lot of things. He could have meant it in a way that he knew what he signed up for. And that proves how brave he is, knew what he signed up for, knew the risks, but did it anyways, and made the ultimate sacrifice.
Exactly.
That's probably what he meant. That's what anybody would have meant in that situation saying that. You're honestly telling me. I mean, I understand Trump says things and he doesn't think before he speaks all the time. I get that. He says things flippantly. He just kind of talks and talks, and it can be interpreted different ways. But you're trying to convince me, and maybe, you know, maybe the audio will come out and I'll have to completely change my mind. Fine. But you're trying to convince me that Trump came out and said, well, he knew what he signed up for. It's no big deal. Oh, yeah, he's dead. Yeah, oh, he's dead. Oh, well, you know what he signed up for. You're telling me that that's what you believe, that Trump said it that way? I don't think anyone really believes that. This whole story is just unbelievable to me that this is where we are. This is where we are. This has been the talk today. And it's really convenient that this came out today because there was a big story that came out, two big stories that came out, one about Comey, and one about Hillary Clinton and the Obama Justice Department dealing with Russia. And it's really convenient that this has been the big story when those other stories have all of a sudden been kind of buried. And then you also have Jeff Sessions, Attorney General Jeff Sessions, speaking to the Senate today. And he was grilled trying to bring back that whole controversy with apparently Trump collusion in Russia. And I looked online on Google News today, and they had a whole bunch of stories trying to bring back the Trump-Russia collusion when the big stories are about Russia but have nothing to do with Trump. It just seems all convenient to me. What do you think? 407-916-5400. Text to 23680. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
If you miss any of the show, you can download the Beyond Reason podcast on iTunes. The voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason is back now.
All right, so here's a headline for you from CNN of all places. Gold Star Father, Trump's words misconstrued. The father of a slain U.S. serviceman told CNN he believes critics of President Donald Trump's reported comments to a soldier's widow mistook his intended meaning. This comes after what we just talked about, talking about what Frederica Wilson said of Trump. He says that it was misconstrued. He says basically what I said. That if he did say it, he meant it as it's, you know, as its honor. He knew what he signed up for, but it still hurts. It wasn't meant to be offensive. I don't know. I understand people have this total hatred of Trump and they just believe the worst of him no matter what. But this whole idea that he really is that insensitive, that he doesn't care about the troops and doesn't care about the families of fallen soldiers. Come on. You really have to get me to just suspend a lot of belief for that. So something else happened today. Attorney General Jeff Sessions came out. He was in a Senate hearing talking about Russia and all this stuff. And you would think the big topic would be, I don't know, what's going on with Russia and Hillary when she was Secretary of State. But no, they decided to get into something else. So Al Franken and Jeff Sessions got into this little exchange today. And like I said, it's convenient that this happened today. Here it is. Go ahead and play that.
Since you have qualified your denial to say that you did not, quote, discuss issues of the campaign with Russians, what, in your view, constitutes issues of the campaign?
Well, let me just say this without hesitation, that I conducted no improper discussions with Russians at any time regarding a campaign or any other item facing this country.
Okay, how do you
know? I want to say that first. And that's been the suggestion that you've raised and others, that it was somehow we had conversations that were improper.
May I suggest that?
You had a long time, Senator Franken. I'd like to respond.
Okay.
I think I have a...
Note that Senator Cruz went 2 minutes over, so I don't want... they're going to cut me off, and so I want to ask you some questions.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have to sit in here and listen to his...
You're the one who
charges without having a chance to respond. Give me a break.
So they got into a heated exchange, but the reason why I bring that up is because it just seems really convenient that this is coming out today. So there was a report by The Hill today. Here's the headline. Bud went over it in the morning show. Same thing. FBI uncovered Russian bribery plot before Obama administration approved controversial nuclear deal with Moscow. And then there was another report also by The Hill that came out that an FBI informant tried to get out the information on that, and the Department of Justice blocked that FBI informant from getting out the information.
Under
Eric Holder. Yeah, this is all happening under the Obama administration, under Eric Holder, under the Department of Justice. So the FBI informant also was trying to get the information out on this, and he couldn't. He was blocked by Eric Holder. This report comes out today. So here's the basics of the report. Before the Obama administration approved a controversial deal in 2010, giving Moscow control of a large swath of American uranium, the FBI had gathered substantial evidence that Russian nuclear industry officials were engaged in bribery, kickbacks, extortion, and money laundering designed to grow Vladimir Putin's atomic energy business inside the United States. It's according to government documents and interviews. They also found that basically they were trying to funnel that money through the Clinton Foundation. So they also obtained an eyewitness account backed by documents indicating Russian nuclear officials had routed millions of dollars to the U.S. designed to benefit former Bill Clinton's charitable foundation during the same time Secretary of State Hillary Clinton served on a government body that provided a favorable decision to Moscow. Now, this is something that was in the book Clinton Cash, some of this. But they didn't have a direct connection. But The Hill puts this out. And this isn't some conservative rag. This is The Hill. It's a pretty reputable source. They come out and they say, this seems like an awful coincidence that this Kremlin-backed agency, which has been trying to bribe people to get more information, puts money into the Clinton Foundation, and then they approve uranium. The U.S. approves buying this Russian company. buying 20% of the uranium. Now the Clintons will say they didn't know.
Come on.
I mean, there was even liberals out there who were admitting that something was shady about the Clinton Foundation.
And the other thing about this uranium deal is, where is it now? How much of it got into the hands of Iran?
Who knows?
Yeah.
Who knows? I mean, but right now it's in control of Moscow. That 20% of Americans' uranium supply is in control of Moscow. So this report comes out. I just find it all convenient that this report comes out. This is a big story. There is no doubt in my mind that if there was something like this that came out about Trump, it would be front news, top news right now on CNN, MSNBC, ABC, Wall Street, you know, all those. But today it's getting buried, and Jeff Sessions goes in front of the Senate, and they try to bring up the story of him and the campaign, Trump campaign, being connected to Russia. Now, we also have to remember that intelligence did find proof that the Russians were involved in spreading fake news on Twitter and Facebook. What they found, though, was that Russia spread fake news not only against Hillary, but also against Trump. They spread it on both sides. They also did that during the whole NFL controversy, which is still going on, which we're going to talk about later in the show. They spread it on both sides. So I believe this is entirely possible, but it's just funny to me this is being buried.
Mm-hmm.
The same day where Newsweek had an article today I saw talking about Mueller's investigation because he interviewed Sean Spicer. I saw another outlet out there that talked about, here's all you need to know about the Mueller investigation into Trump. And then this comes out trying to connect Jeff Sessions to the Russian thing, when the real story today is the fact that it was the Clinton Foundation and the Obama administration who seems to have some kind of shady dealings with the Russians. But I guess it's all just coincidence. Now, I know the some of my listeners out there will, you know, they would never, ever give Trump the benefit of the doubt. But they'll give Obama and Hillary the benefit of the doubt here. You watch. 407-916-5400, text 23680. A lot more to get to in today's show. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
If you heart Beyond Reason Radio, listen to the Beyond Reason Radio podcast on iHeartRadio. Just download the iHeartRadio app and search Beyond Reason Radio. This is Orlando's Smart Talk Radio. Beyond Reason Radio continues now.
So this should be the biggest headline of the day, and it is for a lot of people. It is for me. Raqqa, ISIS capital, is captured, U.S.-backed forces say. According to the New York Times, American-backed forces said on Tuesday that they had seized the northern Syrian city of Raqqa from the Islamic State, a major blow to the militant group, which had long used the city as the de facto capital of its self-declared caliphate. Celebrations erupted in Raqqa, where residents had lived under the repressive rule of militants who beheaded people for offenses as minor as smoking. Jeez Louise, people. You talk about evil in the world. That's what they are. Fighters could be seen cheering and firing celebratory gunfire in the streets, according to residents reached by phone and text message. The United States Central Command stopped short of declaring victory, saying that more than 90% of Raqqa is in SDF control, a reference to the Syrian Democratic Forces, an American-backed militia group made up of Syrian Kurds and Arabs. Another spokesman said the military operation is over. While they fear that there might be some suicide bombers still hiding in the city, it seems for the most part that these American-backed troops have defeated ISIS in the city, which is a major defeat for them. It says, whether final or not, the seemingly inevitable defeat in Raqqa of the Islamic State carries heavy symbolic weight. At a time in 2014, the group controlled Iraq's second largest city, Mosul, as well as Raqqa and large stretches of land on both sides of the border, and it had grand aspirations to increase its territory and cement its rule. The Islamic State leader Abu Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who once spent time in a prison run by occupying American troops in Iraq, claimed to be the successor to the caliphs. You all know this. With the fall of Raqqa, the Islamic State has lost the two most important cities of its self-declared caliphate in 3 months. It was pushed out of Mosul in July and now holds a fraction of the territory it once controlled. Now, then we had that story not too long ago where, what was it, dozens of ISIS fighters were given up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, usually they fight to the death. Usually they kill themselves. They were given up.
That was last week, yeah.
Yeah, that was last week.
Now I also saw where, as of right now, ISIS controls just 3% of the territory in Iraq.
That's a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I saw a headline on CNN, of course, from somebody there who said, "No, Trump did not defeat ISIS."
Okay.
Is what it says.
All right.
Doesn't want to give Trump any of the credit. I found this story here from Investors Business Daily that thinks otherwise.
Mm.
He says, it's from their editorial page, it says, "Trump defeats ISIS in months after years of excuses from Obama." It says, 9 months after President Trump promised to defeat ISIS quickly and effectively, U.S.-backed forces captured Raqqa, which until Tuesday had served as the ISIS capital. The battle now is over. Who deserves credit, Trump or President Obama? Trump claimed it for himself, but he says, before dismissing this as typical Trump self-aggrandizement, consider that for several years, Obama insisted that a quick and decisive victory against ISIS was all but impossible. He even once called them the JV team. He said it will take time to eradicate a cancer like ISIS. He says this is a long-term and extremely complex challenge. This will not be quick. There will be setbacks and there will be successes. We must be patient and flexible. Yada, yada, yada. These were always the excuses coming out from Obama. And he kept insisting that winning the war against ISIS has as much to do with public relations as it did weapons. What Obama didn't say is that the reason defeating ISIS was taking so long was how he was fighting it. A former senior military commander in the region told the Washington Examiner that the Obama White House was micromanaging the war to the degree that it was just as bad, if not worse, than during the Johnson administration.
Mm.
You know,
mm-hmm. In Vietnam. Yeah.
Exactly right. Says, contrast this with Trump. Rather than talk endlessly about how long and how hard the fight would be, Trump said during his campaign that if elected, he would convene his top generals and give them a simple instruction. They will have 30 days to submit to the Oval Office a plan for soundly and quickly defeating ISIS. Once in office, Trump made several changes in the way the war was fought, the most important of which were to loosen the rules of engagement and give more decision-making authority to battlefield commanders.
I remember that, yeah.
Of course he did. And you know the left's going to say that this had nothing to do with it. No way. Had nothing to do with it. Trump had nothing. It was all Obama. I guarantee you that Trump is not micromanaging this. Trump is not a micromanager.
No.
So he's definitely not. So Trump did not micromanage the troops. I guarantee you that. And I guarantee you I'm sure that it went something like, you talked with them, talked with the generals, what needs to be done. They gave him a couple different things. So here we go. And he said, okay, get it done. And they went out and they got it done. I'm almost sure that's how it happens. It says Republican Senator Lindsey Graham, who can hardly be called a Trump lapdog, praised what he said was a dramatic shift in a very positive way, away from the political micromanaging of the Obama years to freeing up generals and troops to destroy ISIS. The result of the shift seems pretty obvious. In July, ISIS was booted from Mosul, and this week, Raqqa was liberated. For all intents and purposes, ISIS has been defeated. Trump did in 9 months what Obama couldn't do in the previous 3 years. Trump's critics will insist that victory was inevitable, given that Obama had severely degraded ISIS over the previous years, and that all Trump did was continue Obama's strategy. But the bottom line is that while Obama preached patience, Trump promised a swift end to ISIS and then delivered on it. Now, of course, we still have to deal with the global ideology. We have to deal with the online recruiting. We have to deal with terrorist cells in the West, in Europe, and even here. And that's going to be around for a while. But in terms of ISIS controlling large amounts of land, which they did under Obama, That seems to be largely gone, and that hurts their ability to recruit. That hurts their ability to gain influence. That hurts their ability to spread. This is a big deal. Even if you don't like Trump, even if you're not a big supporter of Trump, even if you don't think that he had anything to do with it, this is a big deal. This is a much bigger deal than what Trump apparently said or may have not said in a phone call, because a Democratic congresswoman who has hated Trump from the beginning said or didn't say what he might have said or didn't say or whatever. In fact, this is really a bigger deal than players kneeling for the national anthem. It's a bigger deal than all of that. This is us defeating the enemy. And our, you know, our troops don't get enough credit either. We don't have big celebrations like we did after World War II. But this needs to be noted that this happened today. And it's a big deal. Hopefully they can continue on with the fight.
I just wonder, so I'm sitting here listening to you and I'm thinking, did Obama micromanage the war as long as he did? Because it was his way of saying, look at the mess that Bush got us into.
Maybe, or maybe he just micromanaged everything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Maybe.
I'm doing the best we can, but remember, Bush got us into this mess.
Personally, I don't think he feels comfortable, or he felt, he's not president anymore. I don't think he felt comfortable using the military as much on the world stage. He believed that military being out on the world stage made us look bad, made the world hate us.
Good point.
And that, I mean, I guess he did use drone attacks against ISIS militants, which is good. I'm glad he did that, honestly. I know a lot of libertarians don't like that, but whatever. It's a battle. It's a war. You got to fight a war to win. But I think he was uncomfortable using them. So, and Trump wasn't. Trump says, hey, we're going to do what the general wants. I'm going to give you the leeway to do it. Get it done. That's the way it should be. 407-916-5400. Text to 23680. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
It would be beyond reason not to listen to Yaffee on your TuneIn Radio app. Download the app today and search Beyond Reason Radio. The conscience in your ear telling you the difference between right and wrong. Yaffee is back on the air.
Yes, welcome back to the show, everyone. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. We are on till 10 p.m. tonight. I'm going to get a little bit more into the culture wars in the next hour. We have the NFL, who had a meeting with the players, the owners, you know, the commissioner had a meeting with the players, had a meeting with the owners, trying to solve this whole issue of the anthem protest. We're going to talk about that. I have the voice of reason of the day on that as well, on whether they can legally prevent the players from kneeling. So can the owners actually legally get away with forcing them to stand? So that's another issue, and I have a great piece of audio on that. I actually learned something that I didn't know about that. So we'll get that in the next hour as well. And a really interesting piece that I found from Matt Walsh, who I've talked about before, talking about how he doesn't think that there's anything that unites Americans anymore. Nothing. He can't think of anything. Really interesting piece on that. But Tom Benson.
I am.
Yes, that's your name. did you happen to see the interview with Jesus Campos? Was the security guard?
No, I did not. He was on. He's the guy who was the security guard the night of the shooting out in Las Vegas, who got shot.
Yeah.
He
disappeared.
He disappeared for a while. Well, before he actually disappeared, though, he had set up, or somebody had set up for him, a series of television interviews.
Yeah, he was supposed to be on, let's see, I had it here. He was supposed to be on Fox News and four other outlets.
And then he disappeared. And then he shows up today on the Ellen DeGeneres show.
Yep. Yeah. Of all shows, Ellen. That's quite a scoop for her.
Yeah.
Why do you think he chose that show? I can't.
I think some money exchanged hands somewhere.
Oh, see, that's the media background. You understand the ins and outs of this game.
See,
that's why I ask you these questions.
And another thing that you often hear television networks say, we don't pay for interviews, yada, yada, yada. That may be true, but what they do oftentimes is they pay for access to photographs, documentations, and other things that the person may have that they're doing the interview with.
So there's a loophole.
Yeah, that's a way of putting it. Yeah,
that's very interesting. This is why I say, I mean, you have your website, Media Confidential.
Mm-hmm.
Was it mediaconfidential.blogspot.com?
Blogspot.com, yeah. Yeah,
yeah. Check that out. That's inside the radio. I'm mostly radio, but I think you have stories on TV as well, right?
I deal with personalities. So if there's something happening with a personality in TV, we may cover it.
Yeah, it's great stuff. We need to do a segment on every show where you talk about your top story on your site.
Oh, geez.
We need to do that. That's a good idea.
Well,
to add that to the format.
Well, the lead story today was the one that got the most hits was the fact that FCC Commissioner Ajit Pai came out and said that the FCC cannot take away licenses of broadcasters based on content.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So what?
They could take away licenses for not operating in the public interest. They could take it for technical issues. They could take it for a number of things, but not based on content. In other words, he says.
So what Trump said is wrong.
Right. He's going to stand up for the First Amendment and, in no way is he going to, do an investigation into content of the networks. For one thing, the networks themselves are not even licensed. It's their O&O, their owned and operated stations around the country that are licensed.
Yeah, you're referring to Trump's tweet. He had a couple of tweets, actually. He had one where he wanted to force equal time from the broadcasters on late-night television.
Yeah, he thought he should get his chance to say his side of the story.
Yeah, so that, I mean, that's...
But he's got Fox for that. So, I mean, that's a moot point.
Well, there's a million outlets these days. Yeah, you're right. But then he came out and said, with the fake news, because he was upset at the report claiming that Tillerson had called him a moron.
Correct.
And he said, this is fake news. Do we need to threaten, maybe pull their licenses? And that's not how it works.
Right.
it was funny. I was talking with our boss here at the station, who also runs the Florida News Network,
mm-hmm.
And they're a network.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he says, we don't have a license.
That's right.
There's no license. He can't pull, each individual station.
And the biggest offender of them all, as far as Trump is concerned, is CNN. And CNN does not own stations. Their parent company that is merging with AT&T does own one or two licenses, but of stations like I think in Chicago and Atlanta, but that's it.
Yeah.
You know?
So I mean the whole controversy dealing with that. I mean this is why he needs to think before he speaks. Although I don't think he ever really meant it. He says things just to kind of throw out the red meat.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's what he does, and he knows it gets him attention, especially with the culture wars and all that stuff. But yeah, I didn't mean it. But so we had Jesus Campos
mm-hmm.
talking with Ellen today, and he gave he talked about what he experienced. He said, as I was walking down, I heard rapid fire, and then I first took cover. He says, I felt a burning sensation. I went to go lift my pant leg up and saw blood. That's when I called it in the radio that shots have been fired. It seems that everything he is saying lines up with what the police have said, even though the police have apparently changed their story like a bajillion times. Okay, not really a bajillion times, but it's interesting though. Why do you think he disappeared?
I think because he was contacted by Ellen DeGeneres' producers.
Really?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Saying we'll pay you basically.
Yeah, we'll pay you to we'll put you up at a hotel. We'll fly you out here. Yada yada yada. And we'll get.
I have not heard that theory.
We'll get some money your way or make a donation on your behalf to some charity, perhaps. Who knows what it was. And that's when he, quote, disappeared.
So you don't think he's the second shooter?
No.
He's involved?
No.
And no? No?
No.
I don't either, but
yeah.
he's not in the grassy knoll, so to speak.
That's a conspiracy theory floating around out there, huh?
Well, you want to know what the other one is that actually could kind of make sense to me?
Mm-hmm.
There are some who are reporting, and it's not backed up by any reputable source yet, but there are some who are saying that he is an illegal alien. And because he's an illegal alien, he was afraid that this exposure would find him out and he would eventually be deported.
I don't think in this particular incident it would happen. I do believe that the shooter wanted to make an escape, and his escape plans were thrown and compost threw a monkey wrench into those plans by reporting the fact that there was gunshots fired. And that's when the police started converging on the 32nd right. floor, and he knew he couldn't get away then.
You know, it's funny, and you and I talked about this before with all the conspiracy theories, because I have a few people that throw them out to me. But they'll throw out a ton of at once. And it's like, not all of these can be true at the same time.
Yeah.
So even if you believe in a conspiracy theory, it can't be. So they'll tell me that MGM insiders sold stocks right before this happened, which says they knew it happened. And then they'll throw me a story that, well, security companies' stocks went up because hotels are going to start putting, you know, this kind of security in their hotels. So they knew it was happening. So some kind of conspiracy there. And then they'll tell me that, well, he was actually an FBI or CIA informant, and that's what was going on. And then they'll tell me that he was actually some kind of illegal gun runner. And then like not all of these can be true at the same time. And then there's a second shooter and all this stuff. It's like, which one is it then?
That's known as throwing a lot of you-know-what up against the wall and seeing what sticks.
Yeah. I mean, Ann Coulter did have a piece last week where she raised a lot of good questions, mostly about the media coverage, because she thinks it's BS that he made all his money off of gambling, that there's no way that you make that much money just off of gambling. But apparently, from what I understand, he had real estate interests and all that other stuff. So we need to find some answers. But very, very interesting stuff coming up there. And I wanted to get our media expert involved in that as well. All right, in the next hour, we're going to talk a little bit about the culture wars in this country, the NFL, and much more. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. One more hour to go. We'll be right back. Knowing so well that nothing comes from indifference. I look inside of myself. So here is a headline for you. See if this catches your attention like it caught my attention. It says the United States of America no longer exists. That's the headline for you. The United States of America no longer exists. As you can imagine, that caught my attention. And we're going to talk about it and much more. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I am your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason. In a world that is beyond reason, we are on until 10 p.m. tonight right here live on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. But if you missed any of the show, you can catch the podcast anywhere the podcasts are available. You can also like the Beyond Reason Radio Facebook page or follow me on Twitter at Beyond Reason R and catch the shows there as well anytime. So this hour is going to be focused more on the culture wars because that seems to be what everyone's talking about. Nobody cares about policy anymore. No. As long as Trump takes on the NFL, that's what we all are talking about. I mean, on the morning show, I produce the morning show here. We talked about the Russia stuff, you know, the new news on Russia. We could talk about Obamacare. We could talk about tax reform. Not always get calls. You bring up the NFL protests or you bring up anything like that, the phones don't stop ringing.
But we still not have gotten, we have not gotten as far as low as some people. For example, I don't think too many of us can tell you the names of all the Kardashians.
Well, no. Well, I mean, I think some of this stuff is important. I think the reason why people, I wrote a blog about this last week. And you can catch the blog on my Facebook or you can catch it on the website 1025wfla.com. Click on the Beyond Reason Radio tab. If you go to my Facebook profile on the notes, I wrote a blog about the Boy Scouts accepting girls. And I made the point that, you know, people, it was a big topic on the shows. People are really upset about it. And I made the point that I think the real reason they're upset is not necessarily because they think that they should be separated because there are biological differences. I'm not saying that's definitely a part of it. But I think the real reason people were upset about that decision is because the Boy Scouts is a tradition. It's a beloved American tradition in this country that's been passed down through families. You know, their father was a Boy Scout. They let their son become a Boy Scout, and it goes on and on and on. And by letting girls join, they feel like if this is another example where the beloved traditions, the beloved values in our country are under attack. And that's what really upsets them. That's why they get fired up, because it just seems over and over and over again in today's world. Traditions that we all love and hold dear. The national anthem. Columbus Day. And now the Boy Scouts, they're all being undermined constantly. Another one? Halloween. Halloween's another one that seems to be under the attack. We're getting close to that.
You can't wear certain costumes
anymore.
You can't
wear certain costumes. Yeah. All of this stuff. And people are just tired of it. And they're fighting back. So that's what I think. That's why I think the culture wars make people so passionate. Because traditions are important for people. And frankly, they're important for a society. You know, societies evolve and change over time. There's no doubt. But they also have... They also need a foundation. For a society to be able to evolve, you need a firm foundation to build on, to rebuild on, just like you would a house or anything else. But it seems like we're not only rebuilding the house, but we're ripping apart the foundation. And people are upset. But I found this article here, and it's by someone I've talked about many times on the show before. I really need to get him on the show. I mean, he doesn't know me, so I mean, who cares? He's like my age. I think he is my age. Mm. His name's Matt Walsh.
Okay.
He used to work with The Blaze. He just got hired with The Daily Wire, Ben Shapiro's outfit.
So he
left The Blaze recently and got hired by The Daily Wire. And I'm always following him. He's got great stuff on Twitter. He's big on the culture and Christian values and stuff like that. That's why I really like him. But he wrote this piece, and it really caught my attention. It says, "The United States of America no longer exists." He says, "I posed a challenge on Twitter not long ago. It was this. Name one fundamental ideal shared by all or most Americans." Name just one fundamental ideal shared by all Americans. Can you do it?
I'll be sarcastic and say Black Friday.
Black Friday. Well, now it's Cyber Monday. We're divided between Black Friday.
See, there
and
you
Cyber
go. Monday. Black Friday's out the window.
I would say that basically wanting to buy stuff may be the only thing. He didn't say that here, but I think you actually hit the nail on the head. As long as we can still buy crap, that's what we united. Yeah, material stuff.
Stuff to put in the storage bin.
Right. He said this. He said, "Over 200 people attempted to come up with one. Sadly, none of the answers were convincing." He said, "I thought a lot about this over the past several days." He said he was reminded of McCain's speech when he said he was decrying. So McCain on Monday was decrying calls for spurious nationalism, which he proclaimed as, "We are not, a land of blood and soil, but we live in a land made of ideals." And, you know, I think a lot of people would say that we're a land of ideals and principles, not blood and soil. But then Matt Walsh continues in his piece here. He says this. He says, "A land made of ideals? What ideals? Tell me exactly which ideals unite and define the United States in 2017. He says, "I don't want to hear about what ideals united us in 1776 or 1890 or during World War II. Those days are gone." He says, "Tell me about today, this moment. Give me one ideal, just one, that can be said to unite nearly all Americans right now. After all, if we are in a country made of ideals, yet we share no common ideals, then we are not really a country." Remove the bricks from a house made of bricks and you're left with rubble. There you go. Remove the essence from something and you end up with nothing. So what are our bricks? What is our essence? Says most people try to answer by saying things like freedom and equality. But he says, but we are only united by freedom and equality in the sense that we like the words freedom and equality. But if you look at what we consider these words to mean and how they ought to be applied, you find that my notion of freedom is no more similar to my neighbors than it is to the average citizen of China or Iran. You won't find many people, he continues on here, he says, you won't find many people on earth who profess to despise freedom and equality in principle. You will find many who despise it in practice. And I think many in that category live in this country and work for our government. He says, I can easily disprove that freedom and equality thing right off the bat by pointing out that our wonderful nation under God legally exterminates 1 million children a year. And it does so with approval of over half the citizens. He says it doesn't end there, though, of course. He says our freedom and equal country also happens to be one where Christian business owners can be forced to participate in gay wedding ceremonies against their will. 60% of Americans agree that Christians ought not have the right of religious expression if such expression would hurt the feelings of a gay person. 60% of all Americans support some version of socialized medicine. Over half of Americans think their fellow citizens should continue to be forced to fund the abortion industry. A majority believe businesses should be forced to provide contraception to their employees. He goes on, says the situation gets even worse when you look at the younger generations. 40% of millennials think we ought to limit speech that offends minorities. Over half of adults in their 20s don't believe in free market capitalism. Over 30% are avowed socialists. 50% of millennials would give up their right to vote in order to have their student loans forgiven. I knew that would get you
done.
He said the other half couldn't respond to the poll because they were busy throwing Molotov cocktails at cop cars over a conservative speaker on a college campus. He says, I could go on, but you were sufficiently depressed at this point, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You're right.
Thank you very much.
He says, get 100 random Americans into a room and you won't find even half who actually care about freedom. Or they care about a freedom that doesn't include the unborn, Christians, business owners, and taxpayers. Basically, they want freedom for lesbian, atheist, unemployed college students, and few others. He says, I think the above examples pretty much wipe out equality as a uniting principle. He continues on. He says,
you know what the problem is here?
What?
These people just don't realize how good they have it here.
You know, that's so true. It really is. There is a lot of truth to that statement, actually. Yeah. He continues on. He says 40%. He says polls show that 20% of Americans correctly identify transgenderism as a mental illness. 40% believe cross-dressing men have the God-given right to use the bathroom with my daughter, is what he says here. He says this is what millions of our fellow citizens mean when they extol the virtues of equality. He says, so we don't share these principles, not in any meaningful way. What do we share then? He says, Americans used to be united by their common belief in a creator God from whom all rights originate. No longer, a record number of Americans don't. He says, we used to value family, but it's hard to say that we have that in common in a country where an average family consists of 3 people. A record number of women have no kids at all. Divorce is rampant. Fatherless homes are endemic. Record numbers of young people are putting off marriage or swearing it off completely. He says, what else? Language? No, we haven't shared a common language in many decades. What's left? Nothing of substance. Physical proximity? Zip codes? Our vices? We all love to buy things, see? You were right.
Yeah.
Black Friday. Mm-hmm. I think that's true. He says, we all love to buy things. We watch too much TV. Most of us are pretty excited for Stranger Things too. He goes, is that enough to make a country? He says, I doubt it. That's enough for a Reddit community or an after-school club, but not a nation, especially not one that builds upon ideals. He says, it appears that I'm not imagining things when I get the feeling that I no longer live in the same country as my fellow Americans. Many of them exist in a place where there is no God. There is no such thing as a man or woman. There is no truth. There is no objective morality. Babies aren't people. Marriage is a social construct. The whole point of life is to make money and go on nice vacations. And the government's job is to take care of our every need from cradle to grave. He says, I do not relate to a person like this. He is foreign to me. I share nothing at all with him. Ideals? We don't even share a universe. But hey, we both have iPhones, so that's something.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there's a divide between iPhone and Android. Mm. I have an Android, so there you go. this is the worst part of the article, actually. He says, now this is the part where I'm supposed to offer an answer. People will be angry at what they've read. And if I don't wrap it up with a neat little bow, they'll take out their anger at the state of things on the guy who made the observation. But he says this, he goes, well, I don't have solutions. Not easy or definite ones. Who has ever been able to solve a societal implosion while in the midst of it? The Romans couldn't manage it. Neither could the Mayans or the Mesopotamians. Could we be the first to make a U-turn and avert the cliff after we've already gone over it? Now, as long as many of us refuse to look reality in the face, clinging to silly slogans that nobody really believes, Americans love freedom, Americans believe in equality. You know that isn't true. I just spent 1,000 words debunking that argument. He ends here. He goes, here's what I can say. If there's any chance at some kind of national revival, it's only going to happen with God's blessing. So pray and tend to your family. Hold your children close. That's the best way to save a country from collapse and the best way to shield your children from the falling debris if the collapse cannot be stopped. Beyond that, be vigilant. I think there are tough times ahead. Get ready. It won't hurt to buy a gun. He says it wouldn't hurt to buy a gun. He says, if you believe everything is fine and all the indicators I've cited here are really no big deal, good for you. I envy your delusion. I wish very much that I could live inside it, but I'm afraid it won't protect you or your children, though. Best to emerge from the bubble then and look around. We are in trouble. We are not united. We are states in America, but we are not United States. We are not one people. We are not one country anymore. He ends with this, though. I love this line. He says, but at least we still have football. Oh, wait. Never mind. You know, I've talked about this many times, and it is troubling. This kind of stuff keeps me up at night, to be honest. And, you know, I talked about, you know, a few weeks ago how the Russian, basically this Russian sociologist or whatever came out and said he believes the United States will break up. He thought it would have happened already. And at the time, this was like in 2010, I thought he was crazy. And now I'm like, oh, maybe it's possible. When you read stuff like this, it's hard. A lot of this goes back to the fact, though, that this is the times we're in. We're in the us versus them times. Goes back to the book Pendulum, which I encourage everyone to read. I think we can get through it, maybe if we pray and fight for what we believe in, but I mean, I'm kind of like him. I don't necessarily have all the solutions here. It's just something that got me thinking. Maybe you guys have the solution. 407-916-5400. Text to 23680. How do we unite this country again? The only thing I could say, and I've said this before, is we need to learn to peacefully disagree with one another. I think that's the biggest thing. If we could learn to let bygones be bygones, if we could learn to peacefully disagree, if we could learn to just disagree without insulting someone's character, maybe we could get somewhere. Maybe that could be a common ideal we could stand by. But when in the age of Antifa, I don't see that happening. 407-916-5400, text to 23680. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
Listen to the latest episodes of Beyond Reason. Download the podcast at Spreaker.com. The place where we talk faith, culture, and politics. Beyond Reason Radio continues.
Yes, welcome back to the show, everyone. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I am your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. And we have Tom Benson producing today as well. So we've been talking about the culture wars, talking about the divide in the country. And no doubt that the thing that's really got people amped up, and all you have to do is host a radio show and see all the calls and texts you get in every time you talk about it, to know what that thing is. And that is the NFL protests. Now, it really ramped up when Trump got involved, but it was something that was talked about a lot before then. And it's another one of these culture war issues where people feel like their value traditions are under attack. People in this country value the national anthem. They value the flag because they value their country. They still believe this is mostly a good country, even though we are very divided. And when they see people disrespect the flag, they feel like it's disrespecting the country. Now, I've talked about all the arguments. Oh, that's not what it really means and all that stuff, whatever. So the NFL has been having a problem because it's created a lot of backlash. A lot of people stopped watching. People stopped subscribing on DirecTV to the point where they allowed them to do it for free. And so on and so forth. So Roger Goodell, the NFL commissioner, had a meeting with owners and players yesterday talking about this. And he came out afterwards and talked about, you know, what was discussed in the meeting, what he believes, what the future of the NFL is. And here is some of what he had said about it this week.
Everyone should stand for the national anthem. That's an important part of our policy. It's also an important part of our game that we all take great pride in. And it's also important for us to honor our flag and to our country. And we think our fans expect us to do that. We're going to continue to encourage them to stand, and we're going to continue to work on these issues in the community. We'll address issues. I can't deal with hypotheticals right now. We'll deal with those issues if they come up. But for us right now, that's our focus. I think we have a great opportunity here with our players to really work together and to try to help and make differences in our community.
So basically, they're trying to play the middle ground. He's trying to have it both ways. Is exactly what I heard there.
Yep.
So he's trying to get it so, yes, we want them to stand for the national anthem because our fans like that and they don't appreciate that, but we also want to give them the opportunity to be outspoken about issues in the community. And of course, the big issue lately is criminal justice reform. All of a sudden, I hear this all over the place that we need criminal justice reform because there's too many people in prisons. There's too many low-level offenders in prisons and, you know, non-violent criminals in prisons, and we need to let them out. We need to change the whole criminal justice system because it's corrupt, it's racist, it's all of this stuff. And it's not just the black community saying that. A lot of conservatives and libertarians believe that.
There's an avenue for that. It's called Congress. It's called electing officials to take care of that issue. It doesn't play out on a football field, game.
Well, and see, and that's what they don't get. Well, but they're trying to have it both ways because the players, they're trying to make the players happy, you know, but also make the fans happy.
The NFL owners don't have the spine to stand up to the players, and the players like the venue because they get TV FaceTime. Look what they do when they score a touchdown. They dance around and slap each other in a helmet because they know the TV cameras are on them. They're playing to the cameras. If you want this to end, you've got to do one thing. Follow the money. As soon as the ratings start going down and the networks start losing money and the players' pensions are impacted by TV profits, loss of TV profits, then you'll see a change.
But the ratings are already starting to go down, and you haven't seen as much of a change.
Well, now they're saying that the ratings aren't off that much. They're down like 3%, you know. And a lot of that is attributed to the fact that there's more choices out there than just watching a football game. There's other things to do.
But they did a poll last year. Gallup did a poll last year that showed that a lot of people that stopped watching did it because of the Kaepernick protests.
Absolutely, but they won't consider that.
Well, the thing is, this is moving on to basketball now.
Yes, it is.
LeBron James and others locked arms during the national anthem protest. Mm-hmm. He wore shoes that said equality.
Yeah, and how much are these players making? They're poor, oppressed players of the
NBA?
Well,
they're not talking for themselves. They're talking for the oppressed.
There's an avenue community for that. It's called get involved in government and in elections, and that's how you take care of these things, not on the basketball court or the football field.
Well, it turns out that Mark Cuban, the owner of the Dallas Mavericks, is going to let them voice some of their opinions in the first game, you know, before the anthem. So they'll stand for the anthem, but before the anthem, or
that's a concession.
They'll have like a video where some of them can voice their concerns.
They'll do PSAs on TV. You'll see those popping up So
yeah, but this is now it's spreading to other sports. People are just going to stop watching, just like you said.
Amen.
They're just gonna stop watching,
or listen to the games in the radio. Thank you very much.
I think they're gonna boycott, but that's a good idea. Radio is better anyway. But so there is one thing that they keep bringing up in this criminal justice reform. I found some stats here that I'm gonna get to in the next segment. But before we get to that, I want to play my voice of reason of the day. And it's Andrew Napolitano, Judge Andrew Napolitano on Fox News. And he had a little video thing he put out online talking about if the NFL could legally force the players to stand. Now, what he said, he's an expert on this stuff, very interesting. And I actually learned a lot. And so I wanted to play it and then get your take on it as well. Here it is.
Is taking the knee at a football game protected speech? The short answer is it depends where you are when this happens. Because if you are in a state, if the football players are in a state where there is protection for employees expressing their political opinions in the workplace, then they can take the knee. And if the stadium is owned by the government, as most stadiums are, then they can take the knee because the government can't discriminate against political speech, and neither can a tenant on the government's property. All of this presumes that taking the knee is just a political expression, because political expressions are protected everywhere in America, even in the workplace. But if taking the knee interferes with the ability of the team owners to make money because revenue drops or team morale affects team play, then it can be stopped. So taking the knee can't be stopped because the owners like everybody to conform to their idea of politics or patriotism. Or they like the look of everybody standing up as I do and putting their hand over their heart during the national anthem. But taking the knee can be interfered with if it interferes with the delivery of the product, which is a winning football team to make money for the owners. You see, the workplace in America is regulated locally, state by state. And when stadiums are owned by the government, then the owners cannot do whatever they want on government property.
So that's an interesting little angle to this that I had not thought of. According to what he was saying, the owners cannot force them to stand if it's on government property, which a lot of these stadiums are, and because it's considered protected political speech, which some states, done on the state and local level, protects. But there is one caveat to that. If the NFL could prove that them kneeling for the national anthem hurts their revenue, hurts their business, hurts their ability to do business and make money, then they could force them to stand. So, of course, they would have to prove that. So there's a lot I didn't realize there. I learned something new there. I mean, most of us think that the employer can do that, but because it's considered political speech, they can't. Now, this doesn't mean that I have to like it. I don't like that they're doing it. It has negative consequences, obviously, for their business.
You are guaranteed free speech in this country. You are not guaranteed an audience. So if the players want to kneel, fine, let them. Just don't focus the cameras on them. Focus on the flag during the national anthem.
Yeah, that's a good point. I have a feeling. I really thought what they were going to do is just have them not come out. Just have them do the national anthem before the players came out. I'm surprised the NFL didn't go with that. I guess they felt that, I don't know, the fans would have got upset, or maybe the players would have got upset because they took away their right to protest.
That's a little wishy-washy, letting them hide in the locker rooms.
Well, apparently that's what they used to do a lot of the games, but very interesting. But what a lot of them are calling for, and frankly, a lot of my friends are calling for this, and I'm kind of one of these people that I'm no longer buying into, not that I ever really did, but these narratives out there. And one of the narratives, we need criminal justice reform. We're putting too many people in jail for nonviolent crimes. The private prison industry is running this country. We're close to oppressed because too many people are in jail. We need criminal justice reform.
Don't break the laws and you won't go to jail. How about that?
Yeah, well, of course, some would say, well, yeah, but cops are racist. They're putting people in jail. Didn't break the laws, but just because they're black, all this stuff. Whatever.
Yeah.
But I have some interesting stats I found here that I'm going to get into that kind of goes against this. My biggest problem with that theory is we keep talking about how crime rates are at like record lows, and then now we want to release people from jails when crime rates are at record lows. We don't see that. Maybe there's a correlation there. 407-916-5400. Text to 23680. I'm going to get into that much more. And I will end the show with things that made Yaffee laughy. By the way, this is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
Download the iHeartRadio app and catch the Beyond Reason Radio podcast. Your safe space for conservative thought, not for political correctness. Yaffee is back right now.
So I keep hearing this call for criminal justice reform. The NFL wants to talk about it. This is a lot of big thing with the Black Lives Matter movement. It's also a big thing with the libertarian movement and the Libertarian Party, that there's too many people in our prisons, that we arrest too many people for low-level offenses and put them in prison and jail for it, and all of this stuff, that we need to get rid of minimum sentencing on the federal level and all that stuff. Need to let more of these people out. The Obama administration believed that. They started pardoning a lot of criminals for the, you know, low-level offenses, saying this is great. But I have some facts on this. I found this. There was an extensive piece in the Conservative Review by Daniel Horowitz. He's usually good on healthcare stuff, but I mean, this thing's like 12 pages long. Goes over all the myths about the prison system and criminal justice reform, all backed up by stats. I do want to say this, though. It's amazing how I keep hearing that we have too many people in our prisons for low-level offenses for too long. So I hear that in one person. And then the next day, I'll see a story, and we all see them all the time. I'll see a story about someone like, say, Markeith Lloyd, who had a rap sheet as long as your arm for all kinds of stuff. Yet he was still out on the streets, and he was able eventually to kill his girlfriend and a cop, a Black woman cop, by the way. So, and we hear stories about that all the time, where this person ends up committing a violent act or murder or rape, and they arrest him, and they find out he had a rap sheet, a huge rap sheet, all these past criminal history, and yet somehow he was still out on the streets. So I hear all those stories, but I'm supposed to believe that we're putting too many people in prison for too long? Doesn't make sense. But let's look at the stats here. One of the biggest things that always gets me is we hear that we have record low crime rates right now, even though they're starting to go up a little bit in the past couple of years. Well, let's look at the history then. Violent crime began exploding in the 1960s in this country, rising from 161 violent crimes per 100,000 people in 1960 to 597 in 1980. You know what's amazing about that, too? The 60s was the era of the counterculture. But it was also the era of welfare, the Great Society, the War on Poverty. I think there might be a correlation there. I'm just saying. But what they found, okay, it was around this time that the prison population began rising sharply, but mainly on the state level. The federal mandatory minimum laws pushed by President Reagan were implemented in 1984 and 1986. Now, there was a little bit of a lag. Violent crime kept rising for another decade, topping out at 758 per 100,000 in 1991. But then it finally broke. The years of tougher sentencing finally paid off. Crime dropped like a rock for two decades and stood at 376 per 100,000 people in 2014. Still not as low as it was before 1960, but that's a dramatic drop since 1960 all the way to 2014. It seems that this is exactly when they started putting in tougher criminal penalties and putting people in prisons. And if you look at all you have to do is look at the graphs. I mean, they almost correlate exactly. As soon as the minimum sentencing laws went into effect, almost as soon, The prison population went up. The violent crime rate went down. I mean, it's easy to see. Look at the stats. Yet we're supposed to believe that, oh, well, there's no relation here. We need to let people out of prison. And he goes over another thing. He says one of the other myths is that millions of people are incarcerated in American prisons for no good reason. He says about 25% of the federal prison population is comprised of illegal aliens and possibly more who are non-citizens. We could save money right there from deporting those citizens. It says while there are approximately 1.5 million people incarcerated in American jails, prisons, and other institutions, only 195,900 are federal inmates. That's at a 10-year low. And only 159,000 in the federal system are housed in actual prisons. The rest are in privately managed facilities, home confinement, short-term detention, long-term borders, residential reentry centers, pretrial, pre-sentencing holdings, etc. So they're not even all in these prisons. But I wanted to go, the one thing that I found that was really interesting, according to the stats, it says one of the biggest falsities of is the idea that there are too many low-level offenders in prison. And in fact, that's not true. This is according to the U.S. Sentencing Commission. As of March 2016, there were 514 federal inmates serving a sentence for simple possession, of which 95.5% of are non-citizens, meaning only 24 U.S. citizens are serving federal sentences for simple possession, and many, if not all, likely involved more serious charges that were pled down. 96.7% of all simple possession defendants were sentenced in the Southwest border districts, virtually all in Arizona. No mandatory minimum penalty applied in any of these cases, and the median sentence was 6 months. So we're told that all these people were in prison for just possession and all that stuff, and that's not true. It's not true at all. I'm trying to go over some of the stats here. I have a lot of stats. Let's see here. I'm all over the place. I had more stats on that about how little the amount of people are actually in for low possession. Okay, here we go. As of 2015, 1.3 million are in state and local prisons. Only 15.7% have been convicted on drug charges, and 75% of those are for trafficking, not possession. Thus, just 3.6% of the total state prison population is comprised of individuals convicted for simple drug possession. That means the vast majority of people in prisons are there not because of drug possession or anything else, but because of violent crimes. Very interesting stuff. There's a lot more stats in this I'd have to get to. I would recommend going to finding that, and maybe I'll post it on my social media that goes over a lot of this stuff. But I mean, when you actually go over the numbers, and he has numbers here on how it affects minorities, it's not necessarily what you would think it does, and all that stuff. So the fact is, a lot of this stuff about criminal justice reform and how we have too many people in the prisons and the private prisons are running our country is not quite what it seems. And I think a lot of us know this instinctively, that, hey, crime rates are low. Maybe we shouldn't just let people out of prisons. Just saying. 407-916-5400 and text to 23680. Okay, I guess it's time to have some fun here pretty soon. We'll have things that made Yaffee Laffy. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. We'll be right back.
If you like Beyond Reason Radio, well, make sure to show it by liking the Facebook page at facebook.com/Beyond Reason Radio. Your voice of truth in a world of fake news. Beyond Reason Radio continues right now.
Yes, welcome back to the show, everyone. This is Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. We are on, well, just for a few more minutes, and I am Mr. Tom Benson producing as well. We've talked about a lot of different things on the show. In the beginning of the show, we talked about this whole thing over Trump and a call he made to the widow of a fallen soldier. And did he say something that was insensitive? Did he really mean it? Did he actually say it? There's some dispute on that, what he said or didn't say in a phone call. I just can't believe this is where we are in American politics today. They're trying to convince me that Trump somehow hates the troops or is insensitive to the troops. I just don't buy it. It's not in his history, really. I mean, throughout his campaign, throughout his life, he showed support for the troops. So I just don't buy it. We also talked about the culture wars and what actually unites us in this country anymore. We actually had a texter on that who said, he said, the only thing that unites the U.S., people in the U.S., is property rights. We all want our stuff. Even leftists or conservatives, they all want stuff. Otherwise, not so much. It's pretty much, I think where we're at. So there you go. We talked about that and we got into the whole NFL thing. And then I gave some stats on criminal justice reform. I'm going to have to do more research on that in the future because I really want to get into that because this is something I see pushed on my social media and everything all the time is that we need criminal justice reform. And I have to look into that. I don't buy it on the surface. But it's that time of the show once again. Yes, it is time for things that made Yaffee laughy. I threw Tom Benson off a little bit because I played the laugh.
Yes, you usually give me a cue with your lead in there.
That made me laughy. Just throwing you off.
Okay.
That was it. That's the whole segment.
That's it. Good night.
So I don't know if you saw this today, but there was an interesting exchange between Senator Ben Sasse and Senator Ted Cruz on Twitter today.
No, I didn't see it.
Yeah, this happened because... Well, first, this is what happened. While sparks were flying during Attorney General Jeff Sessions' Senate testimony, which we talked about, apparently soda was spilling. In a sorely needed moment of comic relief during Wednesday's Senate Judiciary Committee hearing with Sessions, Senator Ben Sasse followed up a heated exchange by declaring he had dumped a Dr. Pepper on Senator Ted Cruz. The omission came right after Senator Al Franken and Sessions clashed over Franken's Russia-related allegations. He said there was some drama there, Sasse noted, in an awkward moment before transitioning to the soda situation. Sorry to have added to the drama and distracted you for a minute. I was paying enough attention there that I dumped a Dr. Pepper on Senator Cruz, so that what was distracting us on this side of the days. And then they talked about how they're all laughing and everything. As the hearing dragged on, the Dr. Pepper controversy contributed to a bubble up on social media, with Cruz taking punitive measures against Sasse. Says, memo to office, please place a picture of Ben Sasse above the Dr. Pepper fridge in our lobby. He is now cut off, Cruz tweeted, along with a photo of fully stocked fridge of Dr. Pepper and Diet Dr. Pepper. So Ben Sasse tweeted back. He says, I was wearing my Lee Harvey Oswald was framed t-shirt. And then, asked on Twitter if the spill was an accident, Senator Ben Sasse said no comment. So maybe it was true. But then it went on from there. After that whole distraction, Senator Ted Cruz posted a picture in reference to the Zodiac killer. He says, so Ben Sess says, I was wearing my Lee Harvey Oswald was framed t-shirt, and then Senator Ted Cruz posted a picture referencing the Zodiac killer. The reason why he did this is there was a meme claiming, this was during the 2016 presidential campaign, there was a meme claiming that Cruz was the Zodiac killer. Do you remember that?
No. Really?
There was something going around social media during the campaign, and they put Ted Cruz's picture next to a drawing of the Zodiac killer. Apparently drawing, they never caught him, obviously, that saying he was the Zodiac killer.
Oh, jeez.
So Ted Cruz went along with this today and posted a little meme dealing with that. what's really funny, he said opponents of Cruz also took advantage of the meme to create the Zodiac pack in July to fundraise against the senator. Well, what was really funny is the first deaths that took place by the Zodiac killer was 2 years before Senator Ted Cruz was born. So there you go. But they had a little bit fun. So apparently Senator Ben Sass spilled a bunch of Dr. Pepper on Ted Cruz today. And now he admits he's the Zodiac killer. And he's going to go after, I guess he's going to go after Ben Sass. And that's it. Watch out. All right, this has been another edition of Beyond Reason Radio. We'll be back on tomorrow night, 8 to 10 p.m., right here on News Radio 102.5 WFLA. Make sure to catch the podcast anywhere podcasts are available. I'm sure there'll be plenty to talk about. I'm sure Trump will say something in a phone call, and somebody will overheard it, and there'll be a whole debate on what he said, what he meant, how he's actually evil and heartless and cold and hates the troops and hates America, and we're all supposed to just buy it and believe it, yeah. This is where we are. All right, I appreciate y'all listening. I'll catch you guys next time. Oh, will I find some kind of